I was on Twitter the other night and people were messaging me. They're like, Brian, have you checked out the latest Gamers Nexus video where they tested two sticks versus four sticks on their Ryzen 5 5600X? And I said, oh, well, you know, I'm super busy right now testing out all this stuff for you guys too. And then I went and watched the video and some interesting results. I mean, I'm definitely not going to dispute anything. And Gamers Nexus does a lot of good testing. So if you want to go check out that video, guys, I'll put the link in the description below for you. But I thought I'd quickly do some testing of my own here. These are the sticks that I use in my videos recently, especially with all the Ryzen testing. I use two 16 gigabyte sticks of Corsair Dominator CL16 3600 megahertz memory. Now, these are dual rank, or they're two ranks, and putting them in two RAM slots will essentially make it dual channel. So you've got four ranks over two channels. This is typically, I find it's the best sort of balance across a wide variety of CPUs. Now, if I was to add in another two sticks of this to make 64 gigabytes in total, I'm guessing I will probably not be even able to run the 3600 megahertz CL16 profile, but we will test that out later in today's video when we compare this on the 5800X versus four sticks right here. This is some 4000 megahertz Trident Z RGB GeoSkill stuff. And we're gonna put this four sticks in a motherboard. This is only single rank, however. So there's only one side of the memory has memory chips on it, making it one rank. But that being said, we're gonna be testing apples to apples across the AMD CPU, then throwing it on the 10900K and seeing what differences this makes versus this. However, we're gonna do a little bit of a twist, and that is we're going to save these XMP profiles into the BIOS and then load them up for this memory right here. That way we're getting a complete apples to apples comparison here when it comes to testing out two sticks across two DIMMs versus four sticks across four DIMMs. So with that aside, I am all stocked and ready to go just after this sponsor spot quickly. If you want to get a Windows 10 Pro Key license for cheap, then today's video sponsor SCD Keys has you covered. For as little as $14.50, using the coupon code TYC on checkout, you can save yourself 18% and get that key instantly delivered. Links in the description below. So getting straight into the results now for you guys. We've got here four different games tested between the 10900K and also the Ryzen 7 5800X. And the thing is, going into these results and coming out, it's pretty much the same recommendation before I made this video, and that is Ryzen 7 5800X. For me personally, it's the gaming king, especially out of the box without overclocking the CPU itself and locking in XMP profiles. It's the gaming king. It beats the 10900K. And then the thing is, the recommendations, and we'll talk about those later, but we've got here CSGO. Let's pull that up first. And what I'm doing here is I'm lowering the resolution to 1080p. It's not going to be 1440p. It's not going to be 4K. I'm also lowering the settings. So what this is going to do is it's going to extract any differences and it's going to make them bigger. And if there's differences between the memory configurations, they're going to be bigger as well. And what we can see with CSGO here is that the AMD, the 5800X, is beating the 10900K, and it's beating it by quite a comfortable margin. But I'm going to throw up another graph within this game, because the first graph here, we can see that there's no real differences between the memory configurations, except the 831 on the eight ranks over four sticks. And here's the thing about the eight ranks. I actually couldn't get this to work at 3600 megahertz. I had to drop this down to 3200 megahertz because that's all it would boot up on the 10900K. I think it booted up 100 megahertz higher on the AMD system. But the bottom line is, on both systems, it would not lock in the 3600 megahertz over 64 gigabytes, which is another talking point, which we'll talk about a little bit later in the video. But food for thought here, we're going to pull up the Spectre patch disabled on the Ryzen 7 5800X, and then we're going to pull up the patch disabled on the Intel, both Spectre and Meltdown on Intel. And we can see some performance differences here. AMD, the Ryzen CPUs, I found this in the past, they lose performance when you disable Spectre. So basically, out of the box with Ryzen, you don't have to do anything with Spectre and Meltdown. Leave it as it is. You're going to get the best performance. Then on Intel, you will gain performance benefits by disabling Spectre and Meltdown, which is why I disable these updates on all the CPUs that are Intel around my studio. I don't believe in Spectre and Meltdown updates.
I never have, if you're a gamer, that is, or if you're a person with a single end user using this PC at your home for gaming, if you're at an office or you're a business or you're in the server market or whatnot, then you might want to leave these patches enabled. But for most gamers, which is, I guess, the majority of my audience, I'm guessing you'll want to disable these patches because I feel the benefits far outweigh the negatives. And let's, with that aside, move on to Dota 2. And what we've got here is pretty much no difference to write home about on Dota 2. There was very minor differences, but again, that can be variance because I'm basically testing in middle and the units are going to interact very ever so slightly different from benchmark to benchmark. But the numbers are pretty much the same across the board. There's no real distinct winner here between Intel and AMD either. Though the 5800X, I do believe, for what it's worth, scored 1 FPS higher on average than the 10900K. Though, next up, Horizon Zero Dawn. This one is, we're using the inbuilt benchmark. This game apparently recently got a big patch as well, which helps performance. But what we're going to be doing here, 1080p lowest settings, we can see here that this game, we actually get a performance boost from going from 2 ranks to 4 ranks over dual channel. And then we actually lose performance by going with the 8 ranks over 4 dims over 2 channels. So basically the best configuration for Horizon Zero Dawn is 4 ranks over 2 channels. Whether that's on 2 sticks of memory or on 4 sticks of memory doesn't really make a difference. Because again, we're clocking those 2 32 gigabyte configurations at the same 3600 megahertz CL16 timings. That's important too. Now, next up, the last game we're testing here is Shadow of the Tomb Raider. Pulling this up, there wasn't, again, a difference to write home about except for the 2 ranks versus the 4 ranks. And again, we saw the same trend continuing as we did with the Horizon Zero Dawn benchmark. And that is that the 8 ranks didn't perform as good as the 4 ranks, and the 2 ranks didn't perform as well as the 4 ranks either. So it seems like 4 ranks over dual channel is your sweet spot for gaming. Now, of course, the 8 gigabyte configuration is probably going to be the best. But keep in mind, this is another twist to the story, because the higher your memory capacities are, the more strenuous that is on the integrated memory controller. So if you somehow magically got your hands on a 16 gigabyte kit of 4 ranks over 2 channels, you could technically overclock that higher than the 32 gigabyte kit and you could get better results yet again. But the problem with that is that in 2020, I don't believe they do make 4 gigabyte single-sided sticks anymore. So I think that's out of stock. So if you want to go for a 4 rank over 2 channels, then you're going to need to go out and buy 32 gigabytes of memory, whether it be 2 sides of 1 stick, making a 16 gigabyte stick, or if it's 2 single-sided 8 gigabyte sticks. And generally you're going to want to buy the newer stuff because it's going to perform better. It's going to have the higher XMP profiles. So basically in a nutshell, summing these results up for you guys, we saw the performance increases between the dual rank versus the single rank over the dual channel. That wasn't a difference that was bigger on Intel versus AMD. Not in my testing here. I was seeing pretty much the consistent gain on both Horizon Zero Dawn and Shadow of the Tomb Raider on both Intel, the 10900K, as I was seeing on the Ryzen 7 5800X. Now, the reason my results may differ, if these results are differing to someone else, is because I disable Spectre and Meltdown on Intel's side. And I've just stated before why I do that. So hopefully this video has helped you guys, I guess, process. If it's a little bit confusing, hopefully this breaks it down and lets you know that it's not that confusing. It's just basically rank interleaving, where on one channel, you're going to be changing between the ranks as the memory is refreshed. And so that's going to help with that latency. Instead of doing that, it's going to be ready to go on each rank. And so it's going to be ever so slightly faster. And in turn, that's going to help depending on the benchmark. So this is something that's not new in 2020. This has always been a thing since 4 ranks versus 2 ranks on dual channel was a thing in gaming. I've made sure over the last year that I've always tested with four ranks over two channels, and I've just tested with the Corsair CL16 Dominator stuff. And I've used that pretty much in all my benchmarks. And the most important thing is, there's going to be three recommendations coming out of this video. The first thing is if you're a tech reviewer, and I'm probably going to speak on behalf of a lot of other tech reviewers here, and that is, as long as we're doing apples to apples testing, then the recommendations are going to be accurate. So if you guys are going into other people's comment sections saying, oh, you didn't use four sticks of memory, these results are bad, that's not like, it's not a cool thing to do, because you're basically undermining that person's results and all their testing that they've done when there's nothing wrong with their results to begin with. Maybe if they've used two sticks of memory and it's only dual rank, and their overall, their results on both Intel and AMD are lower than other people's, then that could be a cause for investigation, maybe. But even then, they're testing apples to apples. And in a lot of cases, they could be, their recommendations pretty much going to line up with everyone else's. They're going forward, testing these things. There's something I do personally, and that's disable Spectre and Meltdown. I know it's a bit controversial, but I just state my stance on it. And so if the tester wants to do that or they don't want to do that, I'm not going to critique them. That's their testing. That's their way of doing things. But I have my testing and my way of doing things, and that's not going to change, and it hasn't changed. Then there's the third recommendation. You as a gamer, what should you do? Should you go out and make sure you've got four ranks over two channels? And the answer to that is, if you want the highest end experience, so you've got a big hole to burn in your wallet, you want to get an RTX 3090, you want to get the Ryzen 7 5800X or 5900X or whatever you want to get, then yes, four ranks over two channels is going to be the best performance overall for you. 32 gigabyte kit for gaming. Now, me personally, I would recommend going with two 16 gigabyte kits. And the reason being is if you want to say, you find yourself playing less games over time and doing more productivity, you've got the option to add in another 32 gigabytes of RAM, making 64 gigabytes in total. Pretty much all my workstations now have 64 gigabytes of RAM. Though, if you're on a budget, this is the thing, if you're on a budget and money's important for you, the most important thing on a budget is to make sure you've got dual channel. That's the most important thing. The second thing is to make sure you've got your XMP profiles locked in, because those two things are going to be a bigger performance delta hit than going with four ranks over two channels, if that makes any sense. So when it comes to buying memory, I'd say there's three priorities you want to have. The first priority being, make sure you got dual channel. Second priority, make sure you got the speeds upped, XMPs are locked in. Third priority would be making sure you've got then the last, which is sort of like the extra priority, making sure you've got that dual rank over a single channel. So four ranks over two channels. Anyway, guys, with that aside, I hope you enjoyed today's video. If you did, then be sure to hit that like button for us. Also, let us know in the comments section below what you think of dual rank versus single rank, and have you had some interesting experiences that you want to share in the comments section? Because I love reading those thoughts and opinions as always. Just like this one here, it comes from Silver Werewolf, and they say, quality costs, yes, for only AMD it seems, but for Intel in his moment, how was the story? This AMD bias channels. That's the first time I've ever heard that I'm an AMD bias channel. I think I like to call things down the line. And I mean, if you look at my recent Ryzen reviews, I've checked out the value chart, and the 10400F is just ever so slightly winning those value charts. I think I wasn't impressed with the 10900K. But I guess I'm more impressed with the 5800X than I am with the 10900K. And the reason being is because it's a gain generation over generation. The 10900K wasn't any gains over the 9900KS or the K. In fact, you line those CPUs up and they're pretty much going to perform exactly the same in gaming. So that sole fact is the reason why I'd be more inclined to say, hey, the 5800X, even though it's not great value for money, and you're seeing the results here today, right? We've compared the 10900K against the 5800X. 5800X beat it. It's the better gaming CPU. So with those recommendations in mind, it goes to show that one CPU maker has given you a gain year on year and one hasn't. So I don't know what story you want me to tell here, but basically when it comes to Intel, they've haven't given us an IPC boost. I think it's for 5 years running now since Skylake. And that's really affecting them. It's really hurting them as a company, especially for the enthusiast market. So Intel really need to bring out something new. And that's, I guess, they're doing that with Sunny Cove. They're porting it from 10 nanometer back to 14 nanometer, but they're giving the IPC gains. And that's the thing about Intel. Why didn't they give us these IPC gains 3 years ago or 2 years ago? It just, these are the things AMD are doing that. AMD have sort of come up now. And they're surprising Intel every generation. They're not holding back. And now it's making Intel really scratch their heads and say, whoa, where did AMD come up with this IPC from? Where did it come from? And the answer is, it's come up to really, I guess it's the tortoise and the hare, classical race of tortoise and the hare, where the finish line is 2020. And I guess Intel sort of sat at the finish line just before the finish line, being the hare, and then AMD, the tortoise, with the FX bulldozer, is finally caught up. Anyway, there's story time for you. Hopefully you enjoyed that one. If you did and you've stayed this far and you want to see that content the moment it drops, then I'll put the, just hit the sub button, ring the bell, and I'll catch you in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.